亦都夠人啦。
It is about time to make a start. We have formed the quorum. Since the last meeting, we have received three information papers which are set out on the agenda. All the details are set out on the agenda, revised on July 7th. No problem with the papers? If not, let's move on to the second item. Consultancy study on support for carers of elderly people, elderly persons, and of persons with disabilities. Shall we invite the administration in, please? We have received submissions from four organizations expressing their concerns. There are three that have been circulated to members. There is another one which has been tabled before members. Home Care Concern Coalition, Caritas, Senior Citizens Association, Salvation Army, Elderly Association, and also Mental Health, Family Concern Group. So those are the four papers. I'd like to welcome Mr. Chris Soon, Secretary for Labour and Welfare, who is with us for the first time as Secretary. We also have Mr. or Professor Chow, and members who wish to put questions, please press the button to do so. Mr. Chris Soon, please. Chairman, thank you. Chairman, as you said, this is the very first time I attend the Welfare Services Panel as Secretary for Labour and Welfare, and I'm really pleased to join members to talk about this important subject of rendering support for the carers. We have with us Mr. Hector Tung, Professor of Hong Kong Polytechnic University. Mr. or Professor Tung will be taking us through the consultancy study on needs and support for the carers of elderly people and PWDs. Members must be in agreement that in terms of supporting the carers and the elderly people and PWDs, we do have an important role. The SWD has been providing support like the caring skills, counseling, emotional support, respite care, and financial assistance. The idea is to enhance the caregiving capabilities and also to reduce their stress. If you've read the consultancy study in Chapter 2, it sets out in detail all the services provided by the SWD and other NGOs, whether it is centre-based community care or home-based community care. All the details are set out there. In the light of the ageing population, we can anticipate that the number of carers will go up as a result, and that they will be facing a lot of challenges. In order to support the carers, in July 2020, the LWD commissioned the Polytechnic University to conduct the consultancy study that I referred to. The idea is to comprehensively review the needs of carers and see how we can integrate the government's resources to enhance the support. As alluded to in the report, there are nine different economies that are referred to, the US, Canada, Australia, Europe, and the mainland of China. And there are a lot of details there in the report. Professor Tung will be going into greater detail. There are four major directions. I don't propose to repeat them. And there are three levels or three tiers of support. Number one is the strengthen the carers' capacity building. Second, to encourage family and informal support. And third, integration of services. We hope that with collaborative approach, we can have further development. There are 11 specific recommendations. We hope that from the government, the community, and the businesses can take part and join hands to offer their assistance. The LWD is in agreement with these recommendations. We'll be following up on these recommendations going forward. I'd like to hand you over to Professor Hector Deng, who will take members through the consultancy study findings. Chairman, very briefly, I'd like to take members through the consultancy study. There are four aspects in relation to the study. The first one is to look at the all the subjects relating to the carers. And second, as the Secretary said, we had regard to the practices in 9 different economies and see what can be adopted. And third, we gauge the views of the stakeholders and the carers to identify the needs and expectations of the carers. And fourth, we review the financial assistance offered to the carers. There are 8 different items. The first one is the literature review, and the second one is the review of different economies. And we did conduct a site visit virtually to Singapore. And studies 3 and 4 cover the collected carers' views on the needs, strengths, and service expectations. Studies 5 and 6 extrapolated the views of stakeholders in the elderly and rehabilitation service sectors. And studies 7 and 8 explored and assessed the effectiveness of different means of financial assistance to the carers. In particular, study number 8, we conducted a review on the subsidies to see how we can do a better job there. After a year or so of study, we have interviewed something like 5,500 participants and carers. As the Secretary said earlier on, we analyzed the qualitative and quantitative elements, and we have mapped out 4 directions as part of our recommendations. The first one is supporting carers in the community. Second, building carers' capacity. Third, multipartite collaboration. And number 4, ensuring the sustainability of carer support measures. After analysis, we believe that a 3-tier collaborative model will best express our recommendations. So we have this 3-tier and a gear diagram to illustrate that the support on these 3 tiers are intertwined. Now, these 3 tiers are carer strength building, encouraging family and informal support, and also service integration. And there are 8 different areas where we do have specific recommendations. The first tier is carer strength building. Here, we seek to raise the awareness of the carers, and we hope that there will be information which can be made available to them, and we hope that we can enhance their readiness and also their capacity. Let's go into greater detail about each and every recommendation here. First of all, we will raise awareness of the carers about the importance, availability, and access of information, and increase their readiness to seek help. Now, we do have emotional support and some information availability. Of course, there is room for further enhancement. However, the utilization rate is not particularly high, so we have to raise the awareness there. So we are proposing that more information should be disseminated. And we should organize activities to enhance the impact of the awareness. And we should also review all the websites. We should encourage the NGOs, the social enterprises, to build up a carer-centric information portal. Now, we do have the portal now, albeit a little bit scattered, and it doesn't really, it is not conducive to the easy comprehension on the part of the carers. Now, with this portal, it should be interactive, and it should be run along commercial lines. And this portal can also, or should also, carry the mobile apps, and it can be upgraded on a regular basis. And we should also enhance the training and intervention of the carers in order to promote carers' well-being, self-management, and ability to cope with stress. We find that the services are available now. Now we have the DSE and DDRC, but the number of carers who have undergone these kind of training is really minuscule. So there is indeed room to enhance the quality of service and also to enhance their self-management ability so that they will be able to be on top of the situation and manage their stress and their emotions. We hope that this can tie in with the training program of the NGOs. Second, we encourage family and informal support. We hope that the family members can share out the load of the carers. And we should also create a carer-friendly workplace. There are three recommendations here. And the fourth one is to promote family-based support and mutual assistance among peer carers across their lifespan and at different stages of the caregiving journey. We find that the carers are playing a significant role in the family, but in their circle of life, they are really underappreciated for what they do. So there is a need to mount more public education, and we can organize some gathering of the carers and to maximize the effect there. Second, we should cultivate a carer-friendly neighborhood. As I said, the carers do not get the appreciation that they deserve in the family, and nor do they get the right appreciation in the circle of friends. And I hope that there should be a carer-friendly workplace, and we should enhance the caregiving capability on the part of the carers. As I said, we should devise and promote a carer-friendly support environment in the workplace so that we can strike a balance between their work and their caregiving role. Many of the young carers have to look after their disabled or elderly family members. They simply cannot cope with the two roles, and ultimately they quit their job, and this is really a shame.
So We want to create a care-friendly work environment and provide more peer support and more channels for these young carers, for them to express their feelings and views. The last level of support would be a service integration. So we would want to be more efficient at identifying high-risk caregivers and also integrate our different services. We can align the cooperation between different institutions and organizations to provide sustainable assistance. So we have four recommendations. Number 7 is to have a self-assessment tool. Through this tool, the caregivers can identify their needs and understand risks or potential risks that they face, and also understand more assistance programs available to them. So we understand that it's a complex issue. It depends on the individual. So we are devising a tool where the tool can allow for participation, and through the tool, the caregiver can understand the risk factors they're facing, and when necessary, they can seek professional assistance. So for caregivers at risk, they can receive timely support. The 8th recommendation is to identify high-risk caregivers and provide support to them. We believe that high-risk caregivers, they are not aware that they are at risk. They are also not aware of what services are available to them to help them overcome their emotional needs. So one means of identification is a timely assessment tool, a referral mechanism, and we also need immediate response, emergency response services, such as suicide prevention and self-immolation prevention. 9th, we want to enhance their knowledge of IT so that can help them alleviate pressure and enhance their quality of life. Well, we know that we are aware that 90% of caregivers, they are aware that IT can help them, but less than 40% of people have used IT. So our recommendation is, regardless of whether it is online or offline, we should introduce the use of IT and referral programs. We should have rental programs where they can use these tools, and the caregiver and care recipient should have more confidence and in adopting these tools. We also want to cater to emergency needs for caregivers. And in our survey, 80% of stakeholders feel that temporary care facilities are very necessary, but the usage is low right now. So we believe there is room for improvement in matching services. We also need to enhance their understanding of temporary respite services. So we need to promote or convey the message of the availability of respite services and also enhance the quality of respite services. So we need to increase the variety of services and consolidate the existing services and to enhance their quality of service. And ultimately, we want NGOs, social welfare organizations, and so on to provide respite services. And lastly, the service coupon and so on, how can we consolidate these different coupons? Well, in our survey, we found that some services are effective, and economic support is not the only means of support. So for elderly, we hope that the respite services can alleviate the pressure And elderly who are in queues for services, they can be provided with economic support, and there should also be flexible use of service coupons. So caregivers of PWDs, we want to streamline the application process. They can make good use of these subsidies. The cash subsidy should also be aligned with the family income. So that would summarize the consultant's 8 areas of studies and their 11 suggestions. So we hope the government can consider these. Thank you, Professor Tung. I see 9 members who wish to speak. They are Mr. Stanley Lee, Lok Chong Hong, Lam So Wai, Reverend Kun, Zhao Xiu Chong, Doreen Kong, Lillian KWOK, Maggie Chan, and Elizabeth Kwok. Anybody else? If not, then I'll draw the line here. And Mr. Stanley Lee, thank you, Chairman. First of all, I have to welcome Secretary Sun to our panel. So the consultant report is 125 pages. Well, I think it's not substantial enough. Now, as a representative of DAB, this paper that is only 20-some pages, it is a together with another study platform of a total of 40 pages, the content is much more substantial than the 125-page report, so I have some suggestions for the SAR government. They should not feel that the job is completed when the money is spent. So how do you define a carer? That is very important. A lot of carers tell us that the government does not attach sufficient importance to the caregiver. Do we need stress level indicators and so on? And just now we talked about temporary respite services. These are very, very important. The caregivers need a break. They need some. They need to take some time off. And why is the usage of the service so low? Because it's not convenient. Caregivers tell us that they have to travel to receive these services, so they will not use those services. The threshold is also very high. The patient cannot self-care, they cannot go to the washroom, they need to use breathing apparatus, so they do not, the respite service does not accept those patients. They also need early referral. Some caregivers have emergencies. They need a break or they need to run some errands and they need to book in advance. That is not convenient. That should be streamlined. We need some dedicated services for these caregivers. Counseling, some skills exchange and so on. And fourthly, on the issue of money, I heard caregivers tell us that enhancing subsidies is practical and having it recurrent is the largest assistance in the short term. I agree that it's not necessarily the largest assistance, but at the moment it would be the largest assistance. They have to take the care recipient to hospital. They need a travel allowance. Mr. Sun, thank you, Mr. Stanley Lee. I'll have to respond due to I have to give a short response due to time constraints. So what do we mean by a caregiver? Now, I've noted that in Chapter 7 of the consultant report, they raised this issue. They listed a lot of objective reference criteria. So I think we can look into that. You are correct. When we formulate policy or use resources, we need an objective definition. So the consultant report had highlighted that. Second, Mr. Lee has reflected the respite service users' feedback. they need, the caregivers need a break, they need to run some personal errands. So I'd like SWD to respond. So Mr. Chan Deyi, so for the elderly in our daycare, respite services, and we have 40 plus daycare centers, some 210 spaces for daycare. So the elderly, their regular caregiver is not available, and they can be placed at the daycare center. So the usage rate was some 40 plus 50%. We have 49 centers. Are they inconvenient? Well, on the issue of referral, we don't have a lot of paperwork. When necessary, they can book in advance, or even they can even use the facilities without advance booking. Yeah, we understand. Time's up. Lok Chong Hong. Thank you, Chairman. Two suggestions and one question. One suggestion is regarding the a lot of elderly are not aware of the services available. So in our frontline work, we receive questions. We are asked on the street, the elderly, if they knew how to use the internet, they would have access to the information. So one suggestion we have is that the government departments, the dissemination of information, could it be, can there be more access to information? For example, CSSA recipients, OLA recipients, or if they live in PRH, could all this personal information, could they be made members of old age centers automatically, unless they opt out? So once they are members of old age home, old age centers, they can be promotional messages can be pushed to them. So this is the easiest way for elderly to receive information, and I'd like the government to look into that. I understand you need outreach services, and second, we also need to make better use of IT. The coupons now are only available for institutions to apply. There's no individual or family application. So a lot of the elderly need to use IT, especially for those with dementia. We're afraid that they might get lost, they might need. So if they can receive financial subsidies to purchase this equipment, that is actual assistance. The third issue is a question. The community service coupon, it has been a temporary arrangement for a long time now. We're now in the third phase. So we have a quota of 8,000. The Ombudsman in December last year said that they would investigate. So I'd like to see what is the progress of the investigation. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Look. The first question about the dissemination of information. A lot of users have reflected that the information is fragmented. We need to have a more comprehensive, uniform platform. You also mentioned that we have 200 plus elderly community centers, and can they become members automatically, or do they need to apply? Now, I've heard the question. Now, as far as I know, we have some 200,000 members, and we understand that we need to increase the membership. We've heard that suggestion. The use of IT, our fund is targeted at institutions. It does not allow for individual application. So perhaps the Deputy Secretary could supplement. The community center elderly coupon, we are now in the latest round of pilot trials. It should run till September 2023. So after the end of the trial, when we have a conclusion, we can come up and formulate a policy. So, Deputy Secretary.
Yeah, Gao Zhong.
Right, yes, please. Ms. Holly Kwok. Yes, Chairman. In terms of the CCSV community care service voucher, I think we can consider how we can loosen it up a little bit so that the senior citizens can hire the Geron technology products using this voucher. I'd like to add, no time to add, time is up, Ms. Connie Lam. First of all, I welcome Mr. Chris Soon to be with us for the first time. Now, in connection with this consultancy study, I find this a little bit ambiguous because there was no clear definition for caregiver. There are some carers who have expressed their views over the past week or so, and we do have different bureaus and different NGOs making available the service, and there is a lack of coordination, and people will have to run around to different organizations, and there are so many hoops to jump through. Are you going to consider providing a one-stop platform to consolidate all the services? Will you also have a case management system and set up some caregivers unit, like a Parkinson disease center or dementia center? Many carers are telling me over the past weeks that they cannot wait. They cannot wait until the resources become available before they start caring for their elderly members. So they do need to have this one-stop integrated platform to make life easier for them. Now, there are so many elderly people looking after another elderly person, and this is a high-risk situation. Many old people do not know how to express themselves, so with the old looking after the old, it is an undesirable situation. Are you going to be setting up a specific team to look after these people, like having some case management system or offering some counseling for them? For elderly services, you may have a home care service, and you may have a DECC, the District Elderly Community Centers. Things are really very fragmented, and they're not anywhere near enough to look after the elderly. Also, respite care. Professor mentioned a moment ago that the utilization is pretty low, but have you ever considered the reason why there is such a low utilization? Is it because the elderly people do not know how to get access to these services? All over Hong Kong, this kind of respite service, will the SWD give us some statistics, the capacity all over Hong Kong? Secretary, thanks very much. Chairman, thank you, Madam Lam. First off, the definition, as I said in Chapter 7, the consultant has put forward some recommendation regarding the definition. I don't propose to repeat it here. As regards the information which is scattered, the consultant has also alluded to this. We hope that we will be able to set up a portal to facilitate the caregivers. In particular, if they can get access via the mobile devices. Ms. Lam mentioned that with an aging population, there are cases in which the old couples are looking after one another, and the consultant's report made the suggestion that we should have a self-administered assessment tool. Now, this is going to be important. As Assistant Director Chen said, the utilization rate is low for this respite care Now, that's all the whole reason why we have to publicize this, let the old people use them more. Reverend Kun, Chairman, the carers are really troubled by two things. And the first one is the support that they get. I hear you talked about some tea gathering and so on. Are you going to be using WhatsApp or the social media platform? Of course, this should be assisted by the social workers. I think you might wish to use the communication media. That would offer them peer support that they need. And also, point number 10, the respite services. You said that there are some social enterprises or NGOs that are offering this. In Hong Kong, we're running out of space. I've asked a lot of caregivers themselves, and they are of the view that it would be a good idea for home service to be made available. Of course, that might be manpower intensive, but if there are some volunteers that can take part, put them through some training, then it would be far easier to offer these respite centers, because the operating costs are really prohibitively high. If you have a team of volunteers, it will be really very helpful. Now, these carers, they need some breathing space. And if they're in emergency, they simply cannot go to the respite center. Right. Secretary, thanks very much for the specific suggestion. Mr. Reverend Kun, peer support, is this limited to tea gathering, or can it be communication via the social media? Now, for old people, the average caring time is 41.9 hours. For the PWDs, it is 77.2 hours per week. So I do appreciate what Reverend Kun said. If people cannot step away for a while, we will consider how best that we can help them. Now, for the respite care, I can defer to Mr. Chen for further details. Of course, it would be good to have the home service, but it all depends on the conditions of the elderly and the PWDs. If you put someone in the situation unfamiliar to the to the people concerned, it may not be a good idea. I defer to my colleague. Starting from 2019, at various elderly centers, we have created the personal carer posts, and they can provide the respite care. And the senior citizens can stay in the respite center, or where necessary, we can provide a home visit. And there may be some concerns on the part of the family members. There may be good training on the part of the carer. They are really concerned because the carers are there for the first time. They're not familiar with the family setting, and we will be careful with that. But when necessary, we certainly can make available the service. Mr. Chao Xiuchong, Chairman, thank you. Good morning, Secretary. Now, carers, whether it be carers of senior citizens or of PWDs or just simply family carers, that they deserve our support, our respect. They are playing a more significant role these days, and they should get every support that they can get. Having read the report, I feel that it is more like a report that seeks to do the explanation on the part of the government. It doesn't seem like an independent consultancy report, because the researcher doesn't really come down on the side of the caregivers. I am very concerned about the recommendation about the cash assistance for the carers. It says that this subsidy should not be construed to mean that they lose their job because they have to look after the elderly people. Why do you have to impose all these constraints? And they will not be issued in the form of a voucher, and they cannot be applied for as a part of the CSSA. Why do you have to impose all these conditions? For the CSSA recipients, if they go out to work, there is the disregard of the income element. Why can't you apply the same principle here? Also, the scope of application, like the definition of carers, seems that we need to have the assessment of the social welfare department. The threshold is exceedingly high. The bar is so high. And there are very small number of people who can be assessed as caregivers. Now, if you're assessed as caregiver, you have to wait or queue up for the services. So will the consultant be looking at the whole thing from the point of view of the carers themselves? So I hope that there will be some improvement. Also, the cash allowance. Do you have any timetable for implementation, please? Secretary Soon. Thank you, Chairman. Thanks very much, Mr. Chow, for his question. I can defer to Professor Zhang to say a few words here. Regarding the questions raised by Mr. Chow Xuchong, we do understand that the cash allowance under the CCF is also public resources. There has to be some threshold. Now, if the carer is on CSSA, it would be hard to justify why an additional cash allowance should be made available. It's a matter of judgment. Now, we have to be prudent in the use of taxpayers' money. Now, second, the CCSV, it's not an either-or situation. It means that if the carer is collecting cash allowance, some are saying that we should release CCSV in cash. Now, there are diverse views here. Some said that it should be distributed in cash, and some said that it should be distributed in voucher. So I think we have to go down either path. We cannot adopt both, right? We run out of time for this. Perhaps you might wish to communicate with Mr. Chow on separate occasion. Ms. Doreen Kong, welcome, Secretary. I'm glad that you are so concerned about this subject. I've got a couple of points to share with you about the carers. In the consultancy study report, it is about the carers of the elderly persons and the PWDs. Now, this is a rather limited definition. Carers in Hong Kong cover so many different people. It can be someone who had a stroke at a young age, or someone who's suffering from a terminal cancer, or even some energetic elderly people. They need care and attention, or some who are bedridden. I hope the definition can be broadened. I'm grateful to Professor Zhang for all the recommendations, but it seems to me that all these recommendations seem to be rather fragmented. There is a large number of carers in Hong Kong, and they're facing different challenges. Now, all these fragmented recommendations may not be able to address all these pressing problems. My reaction after reading this is more like ticking the boxes. Will the government be formulating more organized or systematic strategies with core focus and with action plans.
New Zealand, when they dealt with the elderly or caregiver issue, the government took the initiative and came up with a strategy action plan. Between 2014 and 18, they weren't very aggressive. They took a step-by-step approach. In the first strategy and action plan, they identified the candidates. They weren't very aggressive. So we can make reference to that rather than a fragmented approach. The caregivers are now a social issue. When we take good care of the caregiver, we are taking a good care of the ultimate care recipient. Now, you suggested having independent institutions running a commercial approach. Well, I'm worried that that might not be most efficient. If you look at Singapore, they have a comprehensive coordination role. There is an agency for care, AIC, Agency for Integrated Care, where all the coordination is conducted. And fifth, I don't need a response, so I'll elaborate. This issue is a very important topic. I hope this is just the first of many discussions. Our panel, our committee could help formulate policy. The government should conduct consultation. They should listen to caregiver needs and other stakeholders. Thank you. Could you perhaps hand your document to the government? So typically the government hands out documents. So in this case, you can provide your document for their consideration. Ms. Lillian KWOK, thank you, Doreen, for your suggestions. If you look around the world, they have different policies for caregivers. And even if you look at social welfare policy, the government plays a coordination role. But over the years in Hong Kong, in the social welfare, especially in the block grant exercise, I've seen a lot of fragmentation. So in the report, I have been looking at the government's role. For example, in point two, you want to examine the websites, the institutions, the NGOs. So all these will be undertaken by NGOs. So even something as simple as a website, can the government coordinate these efforts? Second, the support for caregivers. Now, in the past, I had to follow many caregiver cases, and the impression was when you work with a case, I had to contact four or five social workers for just one case. Now, that is not an ideal arrangement. Yes, each social worker has a different area of focus, but they do not necessarily meet the needs of the care recipient. So when we want to support the caregivers, we want to help them so they can help the final care recipient better. So our software and hardware needs a re-examination. We have to see whether there's any overlap. We need to streamline or be more focused. For example, in a family, each family member would be followed by a different social worker. One might need counseling, one might need the hostel services, and so on. So if we can coordinate these efforts, the social workers will say that this is not my responsibility, you have to follow up with a different social worker. So I appreciate where you said consolidating the services. So I hope the government will examine the whole process, consolidate the hardware, software, I don't need a response. You also need to look into your financial services or assistance, for example, CSSA and other subsidies. Have you understood their needs? The caregivers' pressure, aside from respite services, the centers are not convenient, and financial aid is also important. I'd like the government to consider all issues and examine the existing services. You should streamline your existing services and start afresh and come up with a better policy. Thank you. Before I draw the line, now after I drew the line, there were Judy Chan, Deng Gabiu, and Stanley Ng pressed the button. So they pressed the button after I drew the line, and I'm running short of time. So the three of you, I'll allow you to speak, but with less time, to just 2.5 minutes. Now, Mr. Stanley Lee wants a second round, but I don't think there's sufficient time for that. Maggie Chan, thank you, Chairman. Now we welcome Secretary Sun, and the report and my views regarding the report. My question is, how is it going to be implemented? How can we assist our caregivers? And I have no solution for that. So even though the study took a long time, how can we actually help the caregivers? I think it's not enough. The study purpose lacked an important element, that is the government's initiative, especially as a efficient government. How can we work with the market? How can we be market oriented and human based? I don't see that being achieved. So I want to be more down to earth. So we need to be more human oriented. We need to expand our consultation. The care recipients should have ready access to community services. So the grassroots and other organizations, they need to cooperate further. On the IT side, have you considered when the elderly are mobile, or if they're immobile for a long period, can we have electronic devices that warn us of these scenarios? So what else can the government do? For example, we have different mobile apps. We need services available at our fingertips. I hope the mobile app I'm Smart can provide more services for the elderly. And a lot of caregivers are very busy. They don't have time to handle extra matters. So having an emergency hotline would be ideal. You need to set aside time for a response. Okay, thank you. I'll have Professor Zhang. I'd like to add that I'm sorry. actually, has the government considered local IT meeting local needs that can allow the market to assist those in need? Thank you. I'd like to remind members that this is a committee meeting. We need responses, so you should reserve sufficient time for officials and representatives to respond. It's not we've waited a long time for the report, and a lot of caregivers approach me. They are desperate. And recently, some caregivers told me that they are elderly themselves and they cannot take care of family members. And they asked us to raise the issue in LegCo that they would require euthanasia with their children. And now, after reading the report, I don't see when these 11 recommendations can be implemented. So I hope the secretary can give us a timetable and tell us these suggestions, when can they be implemented? Then we can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Now, the DAB conducted a survey and handed it to the government. I'm not sure have they received this. Now, we had highlighted the problems caregivers face, and we also put forward some suggestions. A lot of our NGOs, different caregivers, have made a lot of suggestions, and they are not too different from the consultant report, and I think it's a matter of time. We understand there are a lot of caregivers, they face a lot of problems, so you should not tell us that we need another two-year study to come up with suggestions. We need measures. So we need things that the government can do before they come up with another report. We know they need more temporary respite services, so why do we have to wait for the consultant report? We can provide these services anytime we want. We know that there's insufficient subsidies. A lot of caregivers, they can't work. They have to take care of the care recipient full-time. So this is not a double subsidy. It's not. There are now currently a lot of restrictions for physically disabled and so on. But we do have physically disabled caregivers that have to take care of the disabled. So why can't you provide them with the subsidies? They also need IT. They don't have, but they don't know how to operate IT. Would you like a response? They also need emergency services. For example, they need to visit the doctor. They can't use public transport. They have to take a taxi. So can they be given a travel allowance? So we'd like you to implement these suggestions and extend them some hope. Let's hear from the secretary. Thank you, Ms. KWOK. In the past, I'm aware Ms. KWOK is very concerned about the handicapped. I hear your concern. Well, regarding the physically disabled, in 2021, the Social Welfare Department had purchased quotas at disabled homes. I've seen these cases. They are facing uphill challenges. Ms. Judy Chan? Okay, thank you, Chairman. I'll try to be brief. I see we can agree that with the report. I have to thank the team for their efforts, and we see that they have a lot of theory, but we also need some action.
And I do think the report has gone far enough. Ms. Doreen Kong cited Singapore, for example. As far as I know, if we really want to support the carers, and Singapore does have a very good policy. They count the distance. If you live far away from your parents, then you can get the subsidy from the government when it comes to home ownership. And I hope that you might wish to consider this. This report represents only the beginning. I'm sure that the Secretary will have more ideas going forward, and Electrical Center would assist. The report also mentions that the foreign domestic helpers are the part of the caregiving. Are we going to put an emphasis on the domestic helpers as part of the caregiving, Secretary? Thanks very much. Ms. Chen talked about the Singaporean experience. We have our unique situations. I heard what Ms. Judy Chen said, but I think we have to have regard to the situation in Hong Kong and provide the support to the carers. If you look at the report in detail, there is a mention that the foreign domestic helpers are playing a significant role in caring for the PWDs and the elderly. Thank you. 2.5 minutes, not 2 minutes. Mr. Bill Tang, Chairman, Secretary, Professor, my question requires some replies. About the elderly and the PWDs, I think that the social worker and the healthcare worker should work together. When I followed up on the needs of the dementia sufferer, I already talked about this. We haven't seen any healthcare workers represented here, or the DSE and so on. I mean, we don't have any representative here. That this is an important partner. How confident are you that you will be able to get the support and the cooperation of the medical sector? And also for the support for the elderly people who have been discharged from the hospital, the hospital authority seems to be moving away from this element. Secretary, the cooperation of the medical sector and the social work sector is important. Today, we're focusing our attention on the senior citizens. So we haven't invited the medical, the healthcare side. Today, the emphasis is more like on the social welfare. I agree with Mr. Bill Tang that the social work and medical collaboration is important, but the carers do escort the senior citizens for medical treatment. What about the support for the discharged elderly people? Would there be further cooperation? There are many complaints about the poor quality of service. Secretary, Chairman, this scheme is intended to minimize the readmission risk after discharge. This has been pretty effective. For the details, I can explore further with the hospital authority. Please carry on. I just shut up when I heard the bell. Well, I don't think we can doubt the effectiveness at all. This service has been serving us for so many years. Perhaps I can liaise with Mr. Tang further about his precise areas of concern. Yes, please. Mr. Stanley, Chairman, thank you. Mr. Secretary and Professor, if I may follow up here. The study started from July 2020, and we were in the grip of COVID at the time. For those who are being cared for and those carers, they do suffer during the pandemic. Have you conducted any study on the mental well-being on the part of the carers and also those who are cared for? During the pandemic, there are many carers who quit their job, and they are under tremendous financial stress. Would you consider offering them some assistance, like the temporary unemployment allowance? Also, the carers need to purchase some equipment or some tools. Will there be any possibility of tax deduction or tax concession? I defer to Professor Zhang about the study that was conducted in 2020. Chairman, indeed, at that time, Hong Kong was in the grip of the pandemic. However, we did have a seminar virtually. We also had focus group discussions to gauge the views of the carers and the stakeholders. We also interviewed the carers who are looking after someone who has some mental issues. And our study is on the basis of eight different areas. We adopt an impartial and fair attitude in making these 11 recommendations. Now, we have so many different recommendations, and we boil down to these 11 recommendations. So there is no question of us being partial, being biased in any way. Right? That's all the time we have for this item. Thank you very much. I'm sure the information gateway, the allowance, and all the rest of it can be further discussed. Well, let's move on to the next item, the cash welfare for the elderly citizens. Shall we invite the administration in, please? Members who wish to put questions, please press the button to do so. I'd like to call upon Mr. Wu Kaiming, Under Secretary, to brief us on the paper. Chairman, at members' request, we have prepared a paper for members' discussion. We have the non-contributory multi-tiered social security system, which covers CSSA and SSA. For senior citizens who cannot fend for themselves, they can apply for CSSA, they can also apply for the OAA, and for those with special needs, they can apply for the OALA or the DA. Now, for Hong Kong citizens or elderly citizens who want to reside in the mainland, they can apply for the Guangdong scheme and also the Fujian scheme. This system covers most of the senior citizens. According to the Census Statistics Department, 1.1 million, or 74% of elderly persons aged 65 or above in Hong Kong, do receive social security payments. So it is 1.1 million. In fact, the government has been improving the system. We have conducted a review of the system, and in 2021-22, we are implementing all these measures. And on the 1st of September this year, we will be merging the two tiers of the OALA. We will adopt a more liberal asset limit, and above 50,000 senior citizens who are on the normal level, they will be getting an additional $900. For those who want to reside in Guangdong and in Fujian, we are going to be relaxing the 60-day residency requirement, and the budget will be $52 billion, taking up 76%, up by 63% compared with 3 years ago. As the population aging, the beneficiaries will increase in number, and expenditure will increase. According to the Census Statistics Department, we're going to see an increase of the population from 20% to 35%. So all these measures will have to have regard to the impact on the finance, and to make sure there will be sustainability of the financial system. Thank you. Right, we have the following members: Mr. Bill Tang, Mr. Norman Kwong, Reverend Peter Kuhn, Mr. Michael Lok, Mr. Stanley Ng, and Mr. Zhao Xuchong, and then myself. 4 minutes, Mr. Bill Tang. Thank you very much for your fast-paced introduction. Indeed, we have to be pragmatic and we have to be rational. If the government is going to be throwing enormous amount of money into the cash welfare for the elderly, definitely there will be implications on the coffers. So we have to be more innovative here. I've got a suggestion here. The poverty rate for the senior citizens is predicated on whether they have any income. The MPF is released in a lump sum, and this is their asset. And we cannot see how this is having an impact. So can we take the annuity as a means to redistribute wealth? If people are relying on the OALA and also the MPF and also the annuity, that the annuity is it's contributory in the course of a career. Of course, the government should make sure that the return will be better than inflation. That way, the senior citizens will, upon retirement, have another stream of income. I'm sure that will not cause a heavy burden on the Treasury. Now, we are talking about the tripartite contribution. We may not have the contribution from the employers, but for the average citizen, if they can have an annuity which is contributory in the course of the career, that will make sure that they will have another stream of income. And that will make the retirement protection system or the pillars that much more secure. We're not asking for anything else in addition. Second innovative idea is this. After the border is reopened, many people will be traveling to the mainland cities for retirement. So other than the bank transfer, can they use Alipay and so on? Can you make available the money by means of the social media platform?
For innovative ideas such as electronic payment. These are touch upon the banking system, so we'll have to convey the message. So the annuity is one of the important pillars for retirement. So we are now implementing a voluntary annuity. The purpose of setting up an annuity is for is to create a stable income in the face of longevity. So should it be mandatory or can we have other incentives? We'll have to consider that. We have to consider what the public opinion is. We have to be cautious if you take a mandatory approach, but I'm asking for a guarantee exceeding inflation. Well, the annuity will involve a large financial expenditure. We have to consider it in greater detail. Leung Man Gong, thank you for responding to the elderly welfare concern. We now have more and more Hong Kong people retiring on the mainland, and I'm aware that the cash welfare program, we only have the Guangdong and Fujian scheme, but according to the census conducted on the mainland last year, they have some data regarding Hong Kong, Macau, and Taiwan residents. So for more Hong Kong people who wish to retire on the mainland, we now have schemes in Zhejiang, Jiangsu, Hainan, Guangxi, and so on. So can the Guangdong scheme, Fujian scheme, be extended to more destinations where Hong Kong people want to retire? They can be given more choice. And I see the paper also talks about relaxing the absence from Hong Kong requirement. So when before the application and after the application, there is a big difference in the calendar dates. So prior to application and after the application, it's hard to imagine a large difference in lifestyle habits. So before application, they can only leave Hong Kong for 50 plus days. And after the application, they can stay in Hong Kong for only 60 days. So when you look into this relaxation, can there be a uniform standard such that we can accommodate the different lifestyle preferences? Thank you for the question. In 2020 policy address, we had promised we would look into this issue. We are now conducting the review, and by the end of this year, we will come back to welfare services panel and seek your feedback. So before application, they can only leave Hong Kong for 50 days. And after the application, they can leave Hong Kong for more than 10 months. That is a large difference. So I think the biggest criteria is proof of existence. The applicant has to prove that they're still living. They are not abusing the system. We are contracting out this work to two institutions. We have people visiting them. We have people who work on the mainland and retire in Hong Kong, so there are similar arrangements. They have to provide proof of existence. And if you want to extend the program to Zhejiang and so on, or other destinations, can we proceed along existing lines? I think it needs further examination. We might even have to liaise with other mainland counterparts, so we have to go back and communicate. Reverend Kuhn, I need to declare that my parents are living in Shanghai, so aside from the Guangdong and Fujian scheme, a lot of people have residence on the mainland. They can be notarized in the mainland. So I understand you require proof of existence, and other legal documents might be of assistance. So aside the fruit allowance issue and the Guangdong Fujian scheme, we also have tax exemption issues that need to be addressed. So I think we'll have more and more people retire on the mainland, but the scheme seems to deter this arrangement, and the retirees' dependents don't get tax incentives. So could you address this concern? Yes, we will communicate with other departments. We cannot handle the tax deduction. So let's say in-laws that live on the mainland, they can apply, and if they have to help take care of grandchildren, but let's say we don't have tax deductions for contributions to mainland relatives. So we'll take the message back, but at this moment we cannot give a response. We'll have to communicate with other departments. Any follow-up, Reverend Kuhn? Mr. Lok Tong Hong. Thank you, Chairman. In the last term of government, there was a special cash subsidy, and we now have a old age living allowance and old age allowance. These are all uniform now. So if we want to increase the subsidies further, that would need more public consultation. But currently, we have the Guangdong Fujian scheme. We have to extend it to the rest of the mainland. So aside from Reverend Kuhn's example, we have a lot of loopholes now. The retirees might provide an address in Guangdong or Fujian, but they could be traveling around the mainland. If they are in Guangdong or Fujian, they provide an address in those two provinces, but they're traveling all over. Let's say their home province is outside of Guangdong and Fujian, then that would not be fair to them. So I'm concerned about the practical issues. We have our Beijing offices. We have to start step by step. We might have to liaise with the mainland counterparts. They can help us handle the applications. Do you have any actual communication with your mainland counterparts or any plans? Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, thank you for the question. I understand that we need to reduce the bureaucracy. You know, the number of applicants, we have to consider the cost efficiency. We now have some 20,000 applicants for the Guangdong scheme and 2,000 applicants for the Fujian scheme. And if we want to apply the current scheme to other provinces, I think we will have less applicants. We'll have even less applicants for Shanghai, for example. We don't have a decision yet, but we can look into this problem. And our main principle is that the elderly person is eligible. They should have some connection to Hong Kong. So that is the basic requirement. Does the government have a review for the annuity program? That can help reduce expenditure. They have a cap at 1 million, and could they apply at a younger age? Can they apply, let's say, at 60 and get paid at 65? The government said they would study this. So labor and welfare, have they consulted with the Finance Treasury Bureau? Well, we don't have the information on hand. So perhaps we can provide information after the meeting. I know it's related, but I don't have the information on hand. Well, if you do have the information, you could forward it to the member. Stanley Ng. The discussion topic indicates that our retirement benefits are deficient, and that's why we need these different plans. So when you look at the totality of all the different plans, it adds up to some 50 plus billion. So in this 50 billion, we need to be more aggressive in how to consolidate them. We need to have a comprehensive retirement package. And just now, Deng Gapio raised the question of annuity. Well, we need some innovation to help the elderly retire. So if we can consolidate it into one comprehensive retirement package, we can save a lot of administrative fees. When you have different plans there, that adds to administrative costs. So that is something we need to consider seriously. The other question I have is regarding the Guangdong Fujian scheme. You are constrained by a lot of tradition, but in the 14th five-year plan, we allow people to retire on the mainland. We allow for retirement benefits. So you are not bound by agreements with the Guangdong government. So the 14th five-year plan is the most important. You cannot limit the scheme to Guangdong province and extend it to other provinces. Thank you for the question. So the elderly benefits do not need a contribution. It is handled through our tax, and we don't have a large tax rate. If you look at other jurisdictions, they might have to make contributions such as a pension. We welcome a non-contributory pension. So this leads to the question of financial sustainability. So how can, as I said in the beginning, 74% we have 70% are complaints. So 74% of people are collecting some form of subsidy, and for those who are more needy, they can collect CSSA.
Well, for those who have more resources, they can get the OAA. Now, this is the SWD's portfolio, and I don't think it would add to the administrative costs per se. I think it has to be targeted in the provision of the service. Mr. Stanning mentioned the idea of linking up with the rest of the mainland. I mean, at the moment, because of the pandemic, it is difficult, but we will certainly consider this. Mr. Chao Xuchong, Chairman, I welcome the idea of merging the normal and higher OALA, and you merge with the highest level, and this is a good move. Now, with regard to the OALA, I hope that the government would consider relaxing the asset limit. It is $300,000 at the moment. It is too low. And from what I heard from the senior citizens, they have only $300,000 in their possession. They don't have any sense of security. If they are taken ill, $300,000 doesn't really get them anywhere. So I hope that the administration might consider relaxing the asset limit further to set the mind at ease. Second, about the annuity, many old people are encouraged to convert their life savings into a stable source of income, and this is a good idea in itself. But many old people are telling me that if they want to collect the OALA, then they will have to lower the asset limit to $300,000 before they can be entitled to OALA. So they have to spend all their savings down to $300,000 before they are eligible. And third, the returns of the annuity. If the returns of the annuity are not pegged to inflation, then they will be very worried. You can expect them to collect $5,000 per month and still be able to survive. So I hope that the government will make the annuity return commensurate with the inflation rate. Undersecretary, Chairman, I fully appreciate the public sentiments, but I'd like to say that for a couple, it is actually $560,000, not $300,000, which is for singletons. And the self-owned property will be disregarded. So should we support the remaining 26% who are more well off in Hong Kong? Is it the way we should spend the money? Now, there are some senior citizens who may have purchased some equity, and they are stuck with the equity because the prices have fallen. Indeed, this is part of their cash, and this is the liquid asset. If they go beyond the asset limit, should we still spend the resources on them. There are more and more senior citizens, and once we've started the allowance, hardly ever would we take it away. I've heard one member say about the annuity, but since annuity is not part of the discussion today, we haven't come with sufficient information, but definitely we will consider that. Mr. Chow, can you make the annuity returns commensurate with inflation? Will you consider this? Chairman, we will talk with the FSTB. It's not something that we can say by ourselves. Will you consider taking this back? Mr. Lillian KWOK, Chairman, thank you. Many members said that the elderly people should be well provided for in their old age, and there is a report on the annuity. I would appreciate if you can make available a copy to me. Second, in terms of the retirement protection, we don't have any good enough system. Will the government consider developing in this direction? A lot of the welfare protection is paid for by public finance as part of the retirement protection. But as indicated in the paper, in 2021, we have 1.5 billion who are over 65, and the expenditure is standing at $51 billion. By 2040, we're going to have 2.65 million who are over 65 and above, taking up 31%. Of the whole population. And with the aging demographics, the expenditure is going to be even higher. So in the days to come, I'm sure that the burden will be ever greater. Now we're talking about a decade or so as time. When we see this scenario, what are the considerations does the government have? Well, we have a number of pillars. There are five pillars in the retirement protection system. Now we do have the safety net here. We also have the non-contributory social security allowance. I think the member is talking about the contributory plans. We heard some comments or some suggestions in this regard. Now, how would the public react to this contributory plan? We understand that the burden is going to be heavier, but where possible, we will offer the best to the members of the public. This is only right and proper for us to do so. But in terms of a contributory scheme like annuity, it is on a voluntary basis for the time being. It seems that the public would like to see some improvement to the scheme. If members have any more mature ideas, we are prepared to communicate with them. In the near future, this is the system that we have. Ms. KWOK? Now, in the coming 20 years, what will be the financial burden? Maybe in 40, 50 years' time, what is the financial burden is going to be like for the government? I hope that you have to consider how best you can improve the annuity and how best you can improve the retirement protection. What is the burden on the employers, the businesses, and the role of the government? I hope that we will have a plan that will be formulated going forward. Good. Mr. Holden Chow, please. Chairman, thank you. First of all, I welcome the proposal to merge the normal and higher OALA because that will benefit a lot more senior citizens, and this is something that has been in the pipeline for a long time. I am going to talk about the absence limit. Now, the Guangdong scheme, Fujian scheme, have been around for some time. They've gone down well with the public. The DAB said that other than these two places, is there a likelihood of extending the scheme to other provinces? Also, maybe the Undersecretary is aware of this. Because of the pandemic, when the limit is they have to spend 56 days in Hong Kong for the applicants. Now, as you understand, some travel to the mainland, and because of the pandemic, once they've traveled to the mainland, they might spend an awful long time in the mainland. And as we said previously, can we, on a discretionary basis, further relax the absence limit in para 17 and 18? There was also a mention of these in 2020. I understand that you made a special, exceptional arrangement. Is it worth considering these exceptional arrangements or make it regular going forward? I understand that in terms of these allowances, we have to exercise prudence, and they have to have ties with Hong Kong. And I do appreciate this point, but the 2 years of pandemic have actually created difficulties for people who really want to apply under the Guangdong and Fujian scheme or the OALA if they want to reside in the mainland. So what is the absence limit like? Are you going to leave it until the end of the year before you would have some ideas? Undersecretary, Chairman, as I said, a review is in hand, and the next meeting is probably going to be the fourth quarter. And I think in terms of the leave limit with regard to the Guangdong and Fujian scheme, my colleague can supplement. Chairman, thank you. Thank you very much for your concern. Because of the pandemic, we do understand the situation. The senior citizens might find it difficult to travel in and out of Hong Kong. Because of the pandemic, since January 2020, the SWD has put in place a special arrangement whereby we would exercise our discretion, and in calculating the period of absence, so when they make the application, or even if they are recipients of the allowance, there is no specific requirement regarding their absence. That this arrangement is still in place. We will pay attention to the pandemic and see how it plays out and make the suitable arrangement. Mr. Chow, Chairman, if we can be more flexible, if we can have more discretionary arrangement, we don't know how the pandemic will pan out. Now, if this is going to prove a feasible proposition, will you further relax the restriction? It's my turn now. I think Mr. Holden Chow does have a point there, because we need to try out the new system. The pandemic is an opportunity for us to try out the new way. Since 2020, the trial has been in place for 2 years. We haven't seen any problems with that. So there is no need for this absence limit. Under one country, two systems, they are actually staying within the same country, and I don't see the merit of imposing all these absence limits, and I hope you will consider this. My question is, in 2021, we have 1.5 million who are over 65. By 2040, the number will hit 2.55 million, which is going up from 20% to 31% of the total population. The government is saying that it will further enhance the measures, and you have to consider the public finance to make sure that the social security system is going to be financially sustainable. Now, with aging demographics in Hong Kong, the demand for social welfare will be enhanced, the measures will be enhanced. Now, how are you going to enhance the system? Will you let us know further how you're going to do it going forward?
Chairman, we will maintain the existing arrangements, and regarding fine-tune or streamlining, we have to bear in mind the government's income and could it be handled through a territory-wide pension scheme and so on, or we don't have any fixed stance right now. Now, in the past, we thought that an aging population was a long way off, but now that is not the case. In light of the aging population, we have to streamline our welfare policies, and we have to be careful of not overwhelming our finances. So we're concerned whether welfare will be cut and whether the elderly would be affected. Well, you need to respond to the public on what you have in mind regarding streamlining. Could we have earlier contributions to annuities? The public wants a better retirement package. The biggest streamlining we can achieve is the absence from Hong Kong requirement that would be relaxed. We can deal with that by the fourth quarter. Now, that would conclude this discussion. Do we have any AOB? Well, this will be the last meeting before summer recess. So when do we reconvene, and what agenda items will be for discussion? We'll have to wait till further notice. That concludes this meeting. Thank you.